Hey everybody, it's great to have you back. We're in session two of our Bold series, and I want to thank just everybody for being a part. Without you, there wouldn't be much happening, so thank you for coming. Thank you for being a part. And already we're just hearing a lot of great things as God is stirring our hearts to make us bold, taking us deeper, stronger, and even more unified than ever before. God has big things for our church. He's led us this far, but He's not done with us. He's wanting to take us to an entirely new level. And it's going to be a very special time as we even just set our hearts towards the Lord between now and our Inspire conference and our Inspire time of just really rallying, praying, believing God for even greater things. We're going to get into Joshua chapter 1 today. So if you have your Bibles, you have your devices, let's get right into it today. We're going to talk about how a bold work in our lives requires a deep work inside of our hearts. There's a place of preparation. There's a place of work that has to happen in order for us to become the bold people God wants us to be. So let's take a look, Joshua chapter 1. I'm going to ask Cheryl if she would just dive in here with us and read this scripture, and then we're going to just take a look at what God was saying to Joshua and to the people.
Great. Joshua chapter 1, beginning with verse 1. After the death of Moses, the servant of the Lord said to Joshua, son of Nun, Moses' aide, Moses, my servant, is dead. Now then, you and all these people, get ready to cross the Jordan River into the land I'm about to give to them, to the Israelites. I will give you every place where you set your foot, as I promised Moses. Your territory will extend from the desert to Lebanon, and from the great river, the Euphrates, all the Hittite country to the great sea on the west. No one will be able to stand up against you all the days of your life. As I was with Moses, so I will be with you, and I will never leave you nor forsake you. Be strong and courageous, because you will lead these people to inherit the land I swore to their forefathers to give them. Be strong and very courageous. Be careful to obey all the law my servant Moses gave you. Do not turn from it to the right or to the left, that you may be successful wherever you go. Do not let this book of the law depart from your mouth. Meditate on it day and night, so that you may be careful to do everything written in it. Then you will be prosperous and successful. Have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not be terrified. Do not be discouraged. For the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go.
That's a great passage of scripture, but it's really kind of interesting when you stop and think about it, because only Joshua and Caleb were going to be allowed by God to go into the promised land. So the Lord allowed everyone of their generation to die off. So now Joshua is being handed the responsibility of leading the people into this incredible place of the promise, the promised land. But it's a generational break. There's a gap between him and the next youngest person. It's just an amazing thing to stop and to think about what the Lord is saying to Joshua. Joshua, you got to be bold. You've got to be strong. Not only are you going to face enemies, but you've got to take this mantle upon you now that Moses is dead. Now you've got to be the one that's going to lead the people. You're going to have to connect with them. You're going to have to step into the things that Moses struggled with, which was casting vision, reminding the people of the call of God, who they are, what obedience and what faith really looks like. And so I think we have to really step back and see that in order for Joshua to be bold, God had to do a work in Joshua. It wasn't just autopilot. It wasn't just something that came natural, nor is it with you and me. We have to be in this place. That's why worship is so important. It's why the gatherings on the weekends are so important. And that's why these life groups are so important, for you to be able to rub shoulders with people of faith, to encourage you, to strengthen you, to be able to bounce things off of, and to really be able to grow in your faith. So for us to be powerful in our community, we have to first be powerful in our own house. We have to have this encounter and this experience with God. And the Lord was coming to Joshua. I mean, how many times did he say the same thing? Be bold, right. Be strong, be courageous. You know, don't turn to the right, don't turn to the left, because I'm going to be with you. Even as I was with Moses, so I'm going to be with you. And I'm going to lift you up. Every place you set your feet, it's going to be yours. But you've got to be bold. You've got to be courageous. And think about that. If there wasn't a reason to be fearful, you wouldn't be challenged head on to be bold. You know, and we're in a culture, we're in a time where it's easy to pull back. It's right. easy to feel like, wow, you know, how is this going to play? You know, am I going to lose my job if somebody knows about my faith? How are people going to react to me? Will I have influence? And so I'm just saying today, we need to understand God wants to use us, mm-hmm. and it begins with a deep work in the heart. We can never just, you know, lose track of the fact that there's a deep work that the Holy Spirit needs to do to prepare us for the next thing that God's about to do. We talked last week that every great work of God, we have to know this, it's going to be contested. The enemy is going to try and rob, kill, and destroy the dreams, the plans, the purpose, and the outcome that God has. And we as the church, we're the hope of the world. And if we get divided, if we get filled with negativity as individuals or even as a church, we're going to miss out on what God has. But if we walk together in unity, we walk together in vision, we stand with one another, we stand with what God is doing, nothing is impossible.
So can I ask you a question
yeah.
on that? Because I think people would be interested in hearing this. So it said on, not in there, not just to be bold, but then it says, do not be discouraged. So there's this, what to do, right? Be bold, be strong, and then what not to do. Do not be discouraged. So something that I feel like you've always been really great at in our family is not letting discouragement be your mantle. And, you know, I think a lot of people struggle with, I don't know how to get out of this cloud of discouragement, right? I'm overwhelmed. I feel the things that are burdening me are so huge. I don't know how to get past that. So real quick, how do you always stay without just living with the darkness of discouragement? Because I've watched you and you, God has equipped you with an ability to press through that and not let that be something that is the last thing you think about at night and the first thing you think about in the morning.
Well, I think that it's exactly what we're talking about right here. And that is that it's a personal work.
Yeah.
And it's one of the things that, yes, I have had to learn, because as a pastor, particularly of a large church, you do take on the burdens of the people. That's your job, is to share, to be in the trenches with them, to be in that place where you mourn with those who mourn, you rejoice with those who rejoice. But, you know, there's a lot of bad news that comes, you know,
right.
when you're in the process of you know, dealing with counties, dealing with cities, dealing with buildings, dealing with people, dealing with finance. And, you know, you have to come to the place where you go to the Lord in prayer. And in prayer, you have to offload these pressures. You have to offload these things. You have to constantly remind yourself. And I think this is one thing that people don't understand often. And that is that they think, well, if you're a pastor or you're a leader, you're at a different place than I am. You don't have the struggles that I have. You don't know what it is to have fear, or you don't know what it is to get bad news. Well, that's just not true.
Right.
That's just not true at all. And the key is to come to the Lord, mm-hmm. and to just come back, even in the Word. The Word is so important. That's why we even study this today, is because the Word brings revelation. The Word brings insight. And when we even see about Joshua being called to be bold, it speaks to me. You know, it's like, Steve, you've got to be bold.
Right.
You've got to realize that you can't be weak of heart. I was sharing with our staff in our staff chapel just a few days ago, and it was with some of the news that we're hearing. You know, you hear bits and pieces, and then things turn, and then it comes back, and it goes over here. And I just said to our team, I said, you know what? You just have to be careful. You cannot allow yourself to be easily discouraged.
Right.
And I think that's a problem. I think a lot of people are easily discouraged. They hear bad news. They let bad news be absorbed in their heart. They just think about it. They chew on it. Instead, what we ought to be doing is throwing off bad news. And we ought to be praying about, okay, God. And we need to be problem solvers. We need to say, God, okay, this isn't working out. You've got a plan. What is it that you want us to do? Where do we go from here? And it's in those moments, whether you're in a family meeting, whether you're in a church meeting, whether you're at work, it's in those moments that the Holy Spirit can come in. And if you pray and you just ask God, go show us the way, it's amazing how many times God will give you a thought you hadn't had.
Mm-hmm.
And He'll give you an encouragement. He'll give you something to stand on. And I think sometimes you just have to understand that God places responsibility. And the more that we respond to that responsibility, you know, the Bible says to whom much is given, much is required. The Bible speaks about sowing and reaping. It talks about if you're faithful with a little, He's going to give you more. So we just have to make a decision. We're going to be bold.
Right.
We're going to trust God. We're going to take one step in front of the other. And we can't be afraid to fail. We've got to be looking not for failure. We've got to be looking for God to show up. And that is just really probably one of the key things that any of us could learn in order to walk with God.
It's good.
So the next thing that just kind of flows right out of that is a good question, that Joshua realized that this was a new generation and they weren't going to be able to go in and take the promised land with, again, what have I been saying? The works of God are always going to be contested.
Yeah.
And so he knew this generation, you know, they didn't have the same test that the previous generation failed on, but they are going to have their test.
Right.
Just like right now, some of you weren't with us in 2002 or you weren't with us in 2010, but you're with us now. Mm-hmm. And you've got to dial in with us as a church and you've got to realize you've got to exert faith that we're counting on you. God's counting on you to be the best you can be and contribute to what God is wanting to do, because we have a whole community that needs to know the Lord. Our church has a vision for across the street, but God is also using us across the world. So you matter. Mm-hmm. And so we need to all understand we're going to have a challenge. Our spiritual life's going to be contested, but there's a way for us to be victorious. And here's where it is. It's in the consecration of our heart before God. In Joshua chapter 3, Joshua calls this new generation for themselves. And basically what he's saying is this: your moms and dad failed their spiritual test. They walked in fear and anxiety and they rejected faith. Now's your turn. You've got to make your choice. Nobody can make it for you. You've got to make your decision. Are you going to rise up and meet the place of faith that God has for you? And so Joshua said to them, he told the people, Joshua chapter 3, verse 5, consecrate yourselves, for tomorrow the Lord will do amazing things among you. And so what he was saying to them is, you've got to search your hearts. You guys need to go home. You need to get on your knees. The word consecrate is also translated as the word sanctify. And so in the New King James and other versions, it will say, sanctify yourselves before the Lord. In other words, come, repent. If there's garbage that needs to get out of the way, Joshua's like saying, listen, you got to wake up. Tonight's the night. Let's get right with God. Let's get your heart right with God. You make your decision. If there's garbage that needs to go out, today's the day, because tomorrow the Lord's going to do amazing things, and you just can't have the hindrance of sin clinging to you. And so they consecrated themselves, and the very next day they went to the flooding waters of the Jordan River. Now, you and I have stood numerous times at the Jordan River. I love the Jordan River. Love to take everybody to the Jordan River. But, you know, it was at flood stage. Right. We've seen it where it's even been almost drought stage. You
right.
could almost
walk across right.
it. But this was, they said, at this time frame, scholars say probably 2 miles wide at flood stage. And they walked to the river. And the moment that the priests were ready to set their feet into the water,
right.
it was then that the water parted. It's interesting, when you read the scripture carefully, it even says upstream, God began to stack water. He began to pile up the water. Talk about a miracle. You can stack wood. It's a little bit harder to stack water if you've ever tried that. But that's the God that we serve. And so the Lord's saying this, you've got to consecrate yourself, sanctify your heart, mm-hmm. realize that sin, disobedience, rebellion, immorality, fears, anxiety, bitter talk, negativity, these aren't pleasing to God.
Right.
And these things have got to get out of the way.
Right.
We can't expect as an individual, we can't expect as a church to go and cross the next Jordan River to touch the I-90 corridor if we're not walking with faith, if yeah. we're not walking in obedience.
I have written in my Bible here, right next to that scripture about where the priests put their feet in, that God can't do the miracle until you obey, that there is a contingency, right? When God makes these promises, there's a contingency on the fulfillment of them. And your obedience is pivotal. Your obedience opens the door.
Yeah,
your
absolutely.
Obedience is it's something that you can't walk away from. It's required to see these things happen.
That's exactly right. Nothing happens in the kingdom of God that is haphazard. God is a God of order. He's a God of peace. He's a God that knows what he's doing. Mm-hmm. And we just have to see cause and effect,
right.
sowing and reaping. Challenge of God, our response. And what a challenge. And I want to just encourage you, how do you grow as an individual? How do you grow as someone who really brings value to God's kingdom? How do you even help build God's church? It's about being faith-filled. It's about watching your words. It's about investing yourself. being involved, not having to be always coddled, coaxed, encouraged, burped, and those things, but where you start rising up as a warrior and you say, you know what, I want what God has for mm-hmm. me. And I'm putting aside the childish things. I'm putting aside the things that once I dabbled in. And man, Lord, I'm coming after you. I want you to speak to me. I want to see the waters part. In fact, I want to get on the other side. I want to enter the promised land. Mm. Some of you today, you're that far away from the dreams and the miracles that God has for you. Your businesses could be completely different if what you're doing is dedicated to God. Your career path can shift. All these things, your family, your marriages, your education path, these things shift. They shift in relationship to your faith, your obedience, and your purpose. If it's all about you and not about the kingdom, then I don't have a lot of confidence in what's going to happen. But if you have a heart that's dedicated and committed to God, you can believe for the waters to part, for the enemy to get out of the way, if your heart is really consecrated and set upon the Lord. Let's continue. Let's go to Joshua chapter 5, because it just continues. The next thing, they get on the other side, and Joshua is realizing that this generation the men have not been circumcised. And in the Old Testament, circumcision was a sign of covenant relationship with God. It was the sign of a man who said, my life belongs to God. I am actually not only spiritually marked, I'm physically marked that I belong to God. And it's interesting because it was, again, the sins of the parents mm-hmm. that were affecting the lives of the kids, because the boys were to be circumcised on the eighth day. So now we're a generation of adults and these men have never been circumcised. So what that meant is, it was their parents that let go of the disciplines and the commitments of the Lord. So I think when you look at this and you see it's the little things that build up to unbelief, that when they faced the giants, they didn't have the courage or the strength to be able to look at the blessing, and it hindered them. Some of you are allowing the little things in life, fears, anxieties, maybe, you know, a little bit of sin, a little bit of just this, a little bit of compromise, and you just think it doesn't matter. But a little bit of this and a little bit of that, it adds up mm-hmm. to unbelief, and it adds up to a hardness of heart, and you miss out on what God has. So Joshua was saying, this is your time.
Yeah.
You need to be committed. You need to pick up the things that have been missed.
Right. And I think what's really important here is that Joshua's reminding the people, how you live your life matters. And it matters not just for you today, but the generations that come behind you will be impacted. Just as much as Joshua's generation is having to pick up a mantle, maybe a broken mantle, and having to rebuild, you know, our job, our goal would be to pass the baton of faith to the generations behind us in such a way that they don't have to go backwards to repair it,
yeah,
but that they can go forward in victory and experience, you know, build on the foundations that have been given to them, and that they're solid foundations. They're not broken or fractured or not level, but they're solid, built on a life that's built and based on the Word of God. And I think it's so powerful. Even, I don't know if you're going to swing back and talk about this, but when they went through the river and how the priest ordered them to get a stone symbolic of each tribe. And if you ever go to the Museum of the Bible, it's one of my favorite exhibits. You go through a 30-minute walkthrough of the Old Testament. And you actually, as you're walking through, there's actually a place that is makes you feel like you're standing, like you're crossing through the Jordan River, and you see these 12 stones with the names of the tribe all stacked upon one another. And it's always, you know, I've been there many times, and every time I go, I visit this many times in a day. But it's so significant to me when I think about our kids. I want them to walk past the Jameson stone, and I want it to be something that they don't just look at and think, well, I'm sure glad my mom and dad did the work. I want it to be something that, you know, my grandparents did this and my parents did this, and this is my turn. You know, I'm speaking to some of our younger people. It's your turn to rise up and to carry these things, this mantle that God wants to put on you. If you just wait for the generation ahead of you or behind you to do the work, you will miss what God is speaking here.
Yeah, that's exactly right. That's exactly what this text is talking about. This text is talking about it. You have to make your choice. You have to decide. Later in the book, as the book of Joshua comes to a close, he stands before the people and he says, choose ye this day. Are you going to serve these false gods as for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord. And that's really what you're going to find over and over again. But it's right here as they're first crossing over, the very first crossing over of the Jordan. And you have to understand what that means. They're crossing over from the wilderness. The Jordan River is the dividing mark into the Promised Land. So when the Lord opened up the Jordan River, they began to, for the very first time, to begin to walk in the land of the promise. Right. And the Lord is saying, if you're going to live in this land, if you're going to walk in the promises, it's got to come from your heart. You've got to be consecrated. You got to be committed. And you need a circumcision, which means it's a deep work in my life. It's not casual. Mm-hmm. It's not flippant. It's not something that doesn't have any meaning to me, but it's something that cost me.
Right.
And one of the most important things any of us can learn in our spiritual growth is that the kingdom expands, our influence expands when we are willing to be marked by the kingdom. When we bring our resources, when we bring our talents and our gifts and our treasures and our jobs and our marriages and our families, and we literally lay them before the Lord in faith and in prayer, that's where the blessing comes. The blessing doesn't come haphazardly, accidentally. It doesn't happen just because you fill a seat every fourth or fifth week. It's because you dig deep. Right. It's because you hunger after God. You want to see the church be strong. You stand with your leaders. You're literally exerting spiritual force that makes a difference. And I want you to see something so important in this text, because they circumcise themselves, which means we want to be a covenant people. The very next thing that happens is the Passover. Here they are, a people that experienced the Passover. You know, their families came out of Egypt, saw the Red Sea part, and then they've neglected to even celebrate the Passover. I mean, it's stunning when you see these things. And so Joshua on the other side has this young generation, just like right now, you know, today our young generation, you can be the greatest generation that's ever lived to this moment. Don't believe all the things. And listen, even in the Seattle area, the rest of the world doesn't live with the mentality and the hardness of heart that is right here in Seattle. So you don't have to live with it either.
Right.
You know, broad is the road that leads to destruction. Narrow is the road that leads to life. This is what God's talking about. They celebrate. They went back to the foundation of giving praise to God, acknowledging, Lord, you're the one that brought us through.
Right.
Nobody else parted the Red Sea. Nobody else took us out of bondage. God, you're the one that's been so good to us. And in the midst of that, they celebrated the Passover. Get this. The very next day, they ate the fruit of the land the very first time. Can you see the correlation between a consecrated heart, laying down the things of the world, coming near to God, celebrating the Passover, thanking God for what He's done, and the next day, the very next day, tasting the fruit that for hundreds of years their people had yearned and dreamed of ever being able to partake of that fruit, and that was the day. Mm. And then you read the very next verse and it says this, the next day, the manna stopped falling from heaven. And what God was saying is, you're a new people in a new day, in a new place, and there's a new blessing that is greater than anything that you've ever had before. Now walk in it. Church, I got to say this to you. You know, yes, we're in a process of trying to believe, you know, to build another phase. Yes, and it's important. We need it. We need space. We need the connectivity. And people who sow and invest in this, it's going to make a difference. There's just absolutely no doubt about it. But it's that's part of what God's called us to do. The other part is to be worshipers, to be hungry, to be teachable, to be seekers of God, and to get rid of the garbage, to get rid of the unbelief, to get rid of the compromises. And some of us are entangled in compromise. And I just believe God wants to lovingly, graciously call you to trust Him.
Yeah.
Get out of the wrong things and put your feet on the other side, because God will lead you, He will guide you, and He will open up a whole new door. Before we close today, I want to talk about one other thing, because in each of our sessions, we're talking a little bit Old Testament, a little bit New Testament. Jesus was preparing to release His church. In fact, the church hadn't even existed to this point in Acts chapter 1. And Jesus said, don't leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift which my Father has promised. And He talked about how you've been baptized in water, but in a few days you're going to be baptized in the Holy Spirit. And He took the apostles and He took the early believers, 120 of them, and He basically spoke to them just before He ascended. And they went into the city of Jerusalem and they went to an upper room for 10 days they sought the Lord as they waited for the coming of the promise of the Holy Spirit. I want you to see the correlation between the promised land of the Old Testament, crossing the river and having the blessing of God. And I want you to see in the New Testament where Jesus is saying, I'm going to build my church and the gates of hell is not going to prevail. But you know what? It's not going to come uncontested, and a deep, bold work isn't going to happen through you until a deep work happens in you.
That's right.
And they went to that upper room, and the same kind of process. They had to get rid of the things that were hindering, places of unbelief, who knows, places of sin. It was God dealing with their hearts for 10 days. And they were seeking, and they didn't even know what it was going to look like, what they were seeking. But on the day of Pentecost, the power of the Holy Spirit came down. And the Bible says in Acts chapter 2 that all of them were filled with the Holy Spirit, and they began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. And from that moment on, the church was birthed. And here we are 2,000 years later, and the same path is what we need to be taking. We need to be filled with the Spirit. We need to be unified, expectant, bold, full of faith. But it doesn't happen on our own. It happens through a deep work of the Holy Spirit in our lives. Our facilitator is going to come. We're going to have some questions for you today. What are the things that are holding you back? What are the things you feel like God is challenging you to do? What's the big, bold thing inside of you that you're afraid to even tell anybody about? And how can you contribute to Eastridge being bigger, bolder, stronger for the sake of God's plans? It's going to be a great conversation. Get involved, share your heart, and I know God's going to bless you. Thank you for being here today.